special guests here today. We've got Joe and Judy Rettley up here up front, who are the benefactors of our Entrepreneur Hall of Fame and huge supporters of the Block School. So thank you for being here today. Joe and Judy have acted as mentors here at UMKC. They've sponsored a whole lot of stuff, helped us with our Entrepreneur Hall of Fame, and have been up here in front of you guys once or twice. So thank you for all you do for us. Appreciate it. Keep in mind, I'm gonna start my other PowerPoint while we're at it. While we are pretending to be able to multitask. There we go. So thank you again for being here. We've got a couple of cool events coming up. So our first Wednesday for next month will be our Roo Idea Jump. This is a idea competition that's based on coming up with really big, cool ideas for the future. That'll happen. Our finals will be May 4th, which is our next first Wednesday. And then after that, we have our Venture Creation Challenge. This is our big business plan competition sponsored by the Rainier Institute. We're looking for really great ventures. We're giving out almost $40,000 in prizes and $10,000 to the first place winner. So it's a really great business plan competition to get involved with. $10,000 is a huge pot of money, would help any venture here, I hope. So please check out our website for both of those events. Registration is coming up soon, so please get those your submissions in and join us with that. At this point, I would like to welcome our Dean of the Block School of Management, Dr. Dave Donnelly.
Thanks, Ben. Good afternoon, and welcome to our first Wednesdays. It's really my pleasure to welcome you to what I'm sure you're going to find to be a very exciting and stimulating presentation. Throughout the semester, inaugural inductees of the Block Entrepreneur Hall of Fame are brought in to speak about their entrepreneurial journeys. And through this process, we become aware of some of Kansas City's most innovative leaders. We're very proud of our Entrepreneur Hall of Fame. We believe the tagline for the Hall of Fame really says it all and what it means to us. The tagline is that the Hall of Fame is a place where we honor bold ideas and inspire bright futures. It's events like today's First Wednesday, where students, alumni, community leaders all come together to honor Kansas City's top entrepreneurs that bring the Hall of Fame to life. We consider this to be one of the speaker series to be one of the great wins for the Block School. If you haven't had a chance to view the Hall of Fame, be sure to take advantage of the opportunity of the reception after the presentation. Look at the honorees, the inductees, and please take time to look at the interactive exhibits that tell their story. It's very inspiring. Now tonight, joining us is Lamar Hunt Jr. He's the founder of Loretto Companies. Lamar is a member of the founding family of Kansas City Chiefs. His father, Lamar Hunt Sr., was inducted into the Hall of Fame in 2014. Frustrated by his repeated unsuccessful attempts to gain a franchise in the National Football League, Lamar Hunt Sr., at the age of 29, decided to form a new professional football league to rival the NFL. That's a pretty bold idea. He was the guiding figure behind the formation of both the American Football League and the Dallas Texans franchise, which would later become the Kansas City Chiefs, which is a franchise we're very proud of. It was also the first AFL figure named to the Professional Hall of Fame in 1972. He was instrumental in the growth of professional soccer in the United States. He founded the North American Soccer League and in 1995 started Major League Soccer. operating as many as three franchises. He brought a similar passion to professional tennis, and his world championship tennis enterprise accelerated the growth of the sport in ways that were unthinkable to a growing legion of fans in the early 1960s. As the president and owner of the Missouri Mavericks, Lamar Hunt Jr. has continued his father's legacy of entertaining the world sports fan. Mr. Hunt further gives back to Kansas City community by serving as the vice president of the Hunt Family Foundation, which is the charitable arm of the Kansas City Chiefs. And he also serves on the board of directors of the Bright Futures Fund, an organization that serves inner city Catholic schools in Kansas City. To speak on the behalf of his family's legacy, to speak on the impact of his family's legacy has had on the landscape of professional sports, it's my pleasure to welcome Lamar Hunt Jr. to the podium. Thank you.
Okay, is this all right? Is this on? I like to walk around a little bit, but I've got to start with a funny story. I think it'll be funny. How many of you know who Don Shula is? Should be pretty much 100%. No, okay, good. There's not everybody. Okay. Don Shula is the only coach to lead an NFL team to an undefeated season. And he did that, I believe, after the 1972 season. And he told this very funny story, and I think you'll find it very humorous. So he's in Miami. He's got a young family. I think he had four kids. And during the summers, they would go vacation in Cape Cod. And what he would do is, obviously, they'd go up there to get into the cooler weather, to get out of the Miami heat. And one day it was raining up there in Cape Cod during the summer, and so he said, you know, we need to go to a movie. So him and his wife gathered up the small children that they had and took them to the movie theater. And they walked into the movie theater, and the lights were on, they'd paid, and they walked in, and people turned around, and they started applauding. And Don said, I took a bow, wanted to acknowledge them. And we sat down and we watched the movie. Well, afterwards, Mr. Shula decided that he really should go greet his fans, so to speak. So he walked up to the first gentleman and he just said, hi, I'm Don Shula. And the guy looked at him and goes, mister, I really don't care who you are. We're just so glad you showed up because they needed more people to pay for the movie so they'd show it. And Don Shula in that moment sort of got an incredible lesson in humility that he's not known by everybody and the world isn't following pro football like you think they do. It's been sort of an honor to be a member of the Hunt family, and I thought I would give you a little bit of a history of our family. It's sort of an interesting one. I did some research specifically for this talk. I knew the stories. Because I have an aunt who's now deceased who did the genealogy of our family. She went back and had it researched. As I stand here today, this is 2016. I'm going to take you back to 1864 in Arkansas. Captain Waddy Thorpe Hunt was my great-great-grandfather. And in that year, he was 42 years old, and he was killed in Arkansas. Now, fortunately, he'd gotten married and had six kids. And his oldest son was called Harrelson Lafayette, was named Harrelson Lafayette Hunt. He was born in 1843. That's my great-grandfather. Think about that, just my great-grandfather. Well, unfortunately, Harrelson Lafayette Hunt fought alongside his father, and that day when his father was killed, Harrelson Lafayette was captured and put into a military prison, and ultimately he was released. And he settled in Fayette County, Illinois. And if you drive to Indianapolis on I-70, you go right through the heart of Fayette County, Illinois. Anyway, Harrelson Lafayette Hunt, my great-grandfather, had nine children. And the youngest, and this is perhaps because they ran out of names, was named Harrelson Lafayette Hunt. That's my grandfather. Harrelson Lafayette Hunt, my grandfather, was born in 1889. Almost 60 years later, he appears on the cover of Time magazine in 1948 with the question underneath him, is this the richest man in the world? How did this come to pass? Well, my grandfather was educated at home. His father, Harrelson Lafayette Hunt, died in a St. Louis hospital in 1911. So my grandfather takes his very small inheritance and, remembering the stories that he'd heard in the family about what it was like down south in Arkansas, he took the money, went down to Arkansas and from Illinois and started running a cotton plantation. And he started to begin to speculate in cotton. And this was during World War I. He made a lot of money doing that. And by 1920, however, the cotton market started to crash, and he owned 15,000 acres of land, and he wasn't going to give up the land. So he decided to sort of look into the oil business, and that was something that was sort of catching fancy then, of course. And he kept the land. He began trading oil leases. Throughout the 1920s, he bought an old rotary rig, drilled, and struck oil. By 1930, he acquired the site of what was at the time going to be the greatest oil discovery in the world, the East Texas oil field. In fact, they're redrilling that oil field. Well, maybe not right now, but they're thinking about redrilling even deeper into that oil well. But the people that are doing it. Well, he had the sort of novel thing that he did. He built a pipeline, his own pipeline, and he supplied Sinclair Oil with their oil directly, with his own oil. And by 1936, he had a company called Hunt Oil Company, and that company lives and thrives to this day. He was a colorful man. He produced so much oil that during World War II that the Hunt Oil Company alone, produced more oil and gas than the Axis powers combined. They didn't have a chance. So, but he was a colorful man. He had seven children, my grandfather and grandma, and my father, Lamar Hunt, was the youngest of the seven. So you can see he was probably just a tad spoiled. So it's sort of interesting to tell that story, to go from the time of my great-great-grandfather being actually killed in the Civil War to a grandfather who was this sort of bigger-than-life character in my life growing up. He was very colorful, he was very opinionated, and we'll leave it at that. Okay. So when I do these talks, I'm going to try to leave you with hopefully a few pieces of wisdom, hopefully. But I kind of want to talk about my dad because it's a great entry point to sort of talk about a person that, you know, obviously we loved. We called him LH, but we loved him. But it helps us kind of clue into something that I think is very important to deliver as part of this message today to you. My dad was born into a wealthy family. He had everything he needed. I mean, he was shipped off to boarding school for 5 years up near Philadelphia. He came back to SMU. He didn't really know what to major in, so he majored in geology because he figured, well, it's the family business. I'll do the family business. It was oil and gas. And, you know, he really wasn't that interested in the business. So for 3 years, he sort of trails around after he graduates in 1956. From SMU, he sort of trails around in the business. He travels to exotic places like Libya and Pakistan, and he kind of learns it, but his heart is somewhere else. It's in football. And the way that the seed got planted was by the guy by the name of Doak Walker, who played for SMU. My dad loved Doak Walker, wore his number in high school and college. And Doak Walker, he'd seen Doak Walker at a training camp for the Detroit Lions back in the early 50s. And one of my dad's friends remembers my dad going to the training camp and turning to him and saying, "Gee, wouldn't it be fun to own a professional football team?" And so who knows what he was thinking at that time, but he was about 20 years old. So anyway, my dad loved sports. And so what he decided was, he was kind of on the fence about baseball and football, but he wanted to bring something to Dallas, Texas, which is where we all grew up. That was where the family was located. And he really wanted to bring a team to Dallas. Dallas had about 700,000 people. He was very interested in baseball. He'd played baseball. Obviously, baseball was the national pastime. But something changed it for him, and that happened in 1958 when the NFL championship game was televised around the United States, and the Baltimore Colts played the New York Giants. And the game went into overtime, and Johnny Unitas led the Colts down the field, and Alan Ameche scored the go-ahead touchdown. Well, it was the clinching touchdown, made the score 23-17. The game was watched by approximately 40 million people, as near as they could tell at that day and time. And my dad became convinced not only of the power of the live television broadcast, but he could experience, in a sense, the crowd's presence in that game and what it really meant. So he thought, gosh, I think I need to go get a football team. So he looks around, he casts about, as anybody would do, thinking, well, I can go buy this business. Remember, once again, he's a very, very wealthy individual in his own right, my father at this time, even as a young man. The family had sort of ridiculous amounts of wealth. And he approaches a team in Chicago, the Chicago Cardinals. At that time, in 1958-59, the NFL had two teams in Chicago. The Chicago Cardinals, which is now today has been the St. Louis Cardinals and is now the Phoenix Cardinals, still in the same family, the Bidwell family. Anyway, he approached them, and they said, no, we don't want to sell. We don't want to sell. We're just not interested. They wintered down in Florida. My dad went down there and visited him again. No, we just don't want to sell it to you. It doesn't matter. We just don't want to sell it to you. By the way, my dad's 26 years old at this time. So my dad gets on the airplane in Miami, and my dad's handwriting is sort of minuscule. And he has this sort of light bulb over his head experience go off. I don't know if that was an expression in 1958, 59, but he had that experience. He had an idea. And he wrote out a business plan for the American Football League on American Airlines stationery, and which is today at Canton, Ohio, in the Pro Football Hall of Fame. And he wrote it out in this minuscule handwriting, and he wrote out an entire business plan on about a 3.5-hour flight. And it's actually pretty sound for a guy that majored in geology. And my dad was more marketing-oriented anyway. The accountants kind of scared him. The numbers guys kind of scared him. But anyway, he says, I'm going to form a league. This is what I'm going to do. I've talked to enough people in this process looking for a team or trying to buy a team that I think I can put teams in markets where there are no football teams. Dallas, Houston, we need to have one in LA, we need to have one in New York, we need to have one in Denver, the different markets that you can think of today, San Diego. So he gets a group of men together, and he finds eight men that are seven other guys that are willing to do it. Now, here's the interesting point in the story, and this is kind of where it gets something I want you to take home with you, if you can think of it, or can remember it, I should say. At this point, we have the Minnesota franchise in the AFL. The NFL figured out these are a bunch of rich guys. They know what they're doing. And they go and make an offer to the Minnesota franchise, and they pluck them away. And then, to sort of add injury and insult to injury, they go to my dad and say, we will take you and Bud Adams, who owned the Houston team, and Mr. Adams just died within the last 2 years, and we will take you and we will put you in the NFL. What do you say? And my dad said, you know what? I've got six other investors with me. We're going forward as the American Football League. We'll go find the eighth team. And unfortunately, we found the Oakland Raiders. And that is true. That's what happened. And actually, Oakland was a great franchise. And they've been a great franchise in their own way. They've been colorful, like my grandfather. Okay. So anyway, that's how the eight teams come about. They go, they play, and basically, by 1962, the AFL championship game is played on December 23rd in Houston, Texas, between the Dallas Texans, which is going to be the Kansas City Chiefs about 90 days later, and the Houston Oilers, and the game is seen by 58 million people on national television. Now, the competition was about three other stations, and one of them probably had Leave It to Beaver or Father's Knows Best on, but still, getting 58 million people to watch anything is an incredible feat. And going forward, well, by January of 1964, the AFL had a $35 million television contract from NBC Sports, and Mr. Art Rooney, the owner of the Pittsburgh Steelers, said, I guess they don't have to call us Mr. anymore. My dad was very formal, and I can imagine him calling him Mr. Rooney, Mr. Hallis, all these great owners, longtime owners. So by 1964, the league was established. They forced a merger. And there's other stories to tell about the Super Bowl and how it was named. It was named after the Super Bowl. My dad is sitting in a meeting. He says, we need to come up with a name to figure out the final game. We can't just call it the AFL-NFL Championship. We could call it something like the Super Bowl. And he just kind of dissed it and said, nah, that's not a very good name. Pete Rozelle, the commissioner, hated the name. The press got a hold of it, figured out they liked it, we trademarked it, and the rest is history with that game. So it was just kind of these types sort of ideas. But I think the takeaway for my dad, as I remember him, he's been deceased almost 10 years, he was a very, very loyal person. And I think that's something to really keep in mind as you go forward, whenever you, in your careers, your business lives, these sorts of things, that he was loyal to a fault, and I think it was a great quality. I really do. In other words, he went to the dance, and he was going to stay at the dance with the people that he went with, and that was a wonderful thing. My dad was a serial investor. There wasn't a sport he didn't like. He's invested in every sport, and there's a lot of stories to tell about that. But what I'd like you to do is think about this concept, and this is what my dad, I think, was struggling with as a young man, as a young person. He had all the money in the world. He could have been all kinds of different things. They had a private plane. They took exotic trips. They did exotic business deals in exotic places, like I said, Pakistan and Libya, places that you probably wouldn't want to go to today as much. But he didn't have earned success. And this is a concept that I'll leave you with, earned success. It's sort of a philosophy, is coined by Arthur Brooks in 2010, that we all have this desire within us to achieve something, but not for money, not for power, not for prestige, but to add value. To add value not only, of course, to your own life, but to add value to the life of other people. What I saw with my dad with all the investments that he made was he gave value, and he wanted people to take a hold of that. Lynn Dawson, who's 80 years old, still alive, still calling the Chiefs games, said, thank God Lamar Hunt realized his dreams, because we all had dreams, and we wanted to realize them too. And Lynn Dawson got a chance to play professional football after sitting on a bench for 6 years in Pittsburgh. My dad made one trade in his entire NFL ownership career. It also almost cost him a coach. In 1961, the Oakland Raiders didn't really have a good quarterback. We had a starting quarterback by the name of Cotton Davidson in Dallas. In the offseason, after 61 season, we acquired Lynn Dawson, and my dad thought this was going to be a pretty good prospect. Lynn's going to be a good prospect. Lynn hadn't played very much. In fact, he didn't even think he could play anymore because he'd sat for 5 or 6 years. So my dad trades Cotton Davidson to the Oakland Raiders because he wanted to make sure that Oakland had a competitive quarterback, competitive situation. Hank Stram didn't talk to him for weeks, the coach. That's the only time my dad ever saw him dabble in that, and he did it without telling anybody, which isn't unusual for dads, right? I'm a dad, I know that stuff. So, but anyway, this notion of earned success, I think it's what drove my dad, and I think it's what drives everybody. It drives me. You know, there's a book on my shelf at home called The Missing Piece, and it's a cute little book, and you can read it to your kids or your grandkids, in my case at this point. And it's basically a story about trying to fit in somewhere. And that's what I think we're trying to do. My dad didn't feel like he fitted in, you know. He was being sort of ushered about at Hunt Oil Company, going about being a part of these big oil deals, but he didn't really feel like he was contributing. He wasn't adding anything of value. So this notion of earned success is something I think you ought to keep before yourselves. Okay. I'm going to change a little bit here because I'm going to tell a personal story here in a second, which is kind of embarrassing, but I've told it enough, I've gotten over it, I think. One of the things I think we have to work on very much in our culture and our society is there's a lot of polarized thinking that goes on. People digging into positions and not being flexible, not negotiating well. And I'm speaking on the political landscape, on a lot of different landscapes. I'm not saying you give up, you know, your core values or your beliefs, but we can argue with good manners. I think we could all use some of that right now. Just let's discuss things with good manners. But I talk about this concept of changing perspective. I'm going to tell a personal story. But if you want to do something interesting, how many here are Royals fans? I mean, is anybody not a Royals fan? Don't you dare raise your hand. Okay. I think we all, even if you're not from this area or you're not into baseball or any of that sort of stuff, we can all say we're kind of infectiously caught up in the Royals. And when you watch the game, you watch the Royals players, you watch it from their perspective. Think about yesterday's game. If you had watched it as a New York Mets fan, you'd have been whooping it up. And I tell people to watch a sporting event and root for the other team. The game pops out completely different to you than when you're not watching your team. It's very interesting. And a couple of things that struck me, there was a couple of pro football players who spent 24 hours homeless. And what surprised them most was not how hard it was to be homeless. What changed their perspective was how people treated them. They treated them awful. How about Joshua Bell, the great violinist, playing a Stradivarius in the subway? So, does anybody know who that is? Joshua Bell, a great violinist. He went down, he put out his case, he played a Stradivarius violin. He made $32 that day. People just rushing by, one, arguably of his generation, the greatest violinist. If you've never had a chance to hear him play, dial him up, okay? So changing your perspective. Okay, I'm gonna give you my story. Okay, I got to get my blush on. Okay. The hockey team, the Missouri Mavericks, it's been a real pleasure to own that team. It's been a lot of fun. It's got a lot of shtick. If you've had a chance to go out to Missouri Mavericks, we're going to make an offer you can't refuse later. But anyway, we opened the season in Alaska. Every 3 years, the teams from our division have to travel to Alaska. So I said, well, we're going to go up there in October. That sounds great. We'll go up. And Alaska in October is not too bad. It was snowing every day. It was cold. But, the snow didn't stick, so I thought it was pretty cool. Beautiful, beautiful place to go. I'd never been there. So the Alaska Aces were the team the Mavericks were playing, and we were going to do a little finish with training camp, and then we were going to play them 3 days in a row. Obviously, this is minor league. You got to strap it on and go for it for three straight days. You can't take a flight somewhere else to go play in between the games. So the second night, we're sitting down in the bowl. It's an old arena built in 1983, and they start playing this theme to the William Tell Overture, and they have this kid, or a person, I should say, running around the arena on a broom, galloping. And so somebody said to me, I said, what's that related to? And they said, oh, it's related to Harry Potter. And I said, well, that's a bunch of shtick, and it's dopey. What a dopey promotion. So we go out the first intermission, and I said, let's go talk to fans, let's go to the tabletops. By the way, the PR guy said it was lame, so the team. So we go out, we get to the tabletops, where there's a nice area, and we're going to have a beverage and just sit back and talk to the fans. And so I'm with this gentleman, a couple of gentlemen, and I'm always curious why people would come to these games, because there's like 5,000 or 6,000 at this game in Anchorage, and I thought that was pretty cool turnout. And so we're sitting there, and the guy goes, oh, I said, well, why do you come to the games? And he goes, well, I come to every game. I said, wow, so you're a season ticket holder? He goes, yeah. He goes, yeah. And I go because that's my son who rides that broom around with that cape. I said, oh, well, what's that about? And he goes, oh, well, he has Down syndrome, and every time he rides, we raise money for it. It's not so dopey or lame, is it? I was looking for a priest after that. Okay, so changing our perspective, not being quick to judge, is very important things to think about. And this is extremely important when you enter into the world of business, entrepreneurship, when you have your ideas, that sometimes when things, how they appear at first are not what they are, okay? But I tell that story and I didn't blush too bad. All right. People ask me what I've been fortunate. I've been very, very fortunate. I have been able to go to every sporting event you can think of. I've seen NASCAR. I've seen the Indianapolis 500. I still have my hearing to testify to that. I have seen the World Series where Bob Gibson pitched against Denny McClain in 1968, two 30-game pitchers. I have seen over half the Super Bowls. I saw the Super Bowl where the Patriots were beaten and their undefeated season went up in smoke. And by the way, the entire crowd was against them that day. I can testify that. Everybody wanted the Patriots to lose that game. I've been to the World Cup. I've been to the World Cup in Japan. I've been to the World Cup in Mexico. I've seen Pelé play in the World Cup. I've seen Johan Cruyff play in the World Cup, who just recently died. By the way, he was a heavy smoker. That's a bad deal. So what else? What else? Well, I have been to the Stanley Cup Finals. I've seen the Chicago Blackhawks. If you haven't been to the Chicago Blackhawks, I would promote that as a once-in-a-lifetime experience if you can get there. By the way, the St. Louis Blues are pretty close. It's a pretty interesting deal to go over there, too. Easy drive. We were there the other night, complete sellout. I've been fortunate to see a lot of sporting events. So people ask me, oh, Lamar, what's the greatest sporting event you've ever been to? And I said, I saw Yvonne Goolagong win the 1971 Wimbledon's final for women, and I said, I can't remember a moment more electric in my life. And here's another story about perspective. Yvonne Goolagong, when she grew up, she was an Aborigine. And Aborigines were treated much like the African Americans were treated in certain parts of our U.S. history, as second-class citizens, degraded, humiliated, those sorts of things, right? Now, well, this is unfortunately still it's in the 1950s. Well, she's 7 years old, and she would frequently go down the hill from where they lived. Now, her father was a sheep shearer, meaning he sheared sheep all day, and he did it physical labor like that. He'd do about 300 sheep a day. Can you imagine that kind of work? You think that would be boring? Her mother was illiterate. So Yvonne is the third of these eight children. I'm not even going to try to pronounce the Aborigine tribe that she's from, but she would go down the hill. She said herself later, she never personally experienced great prejudice, but she saw it happen to many of the people that you know, were she was related to or familiar with, right? Her tribe, if you will, because that's what they called it, a tribe. But she goes down the hill, there's public tennis courts, and she's peering through the curtains, and she's looking, and she's seeing people play tennis. And a gentleman by the name of Bill Kurtzman said, come on over, let me put a racket in your hand. Enjoy yourself. So she went from one side of the fence to the other with just a simple gesture. Come on over, put a racket in your hand. By the age of 14, she was predicted to win Wimbledon by 1974. Well, I got off a plane with my dad in 1971 in London, England, to go to Wimbledon. My dad was there on the business of tennis. In fact, while we were there, there was a headline one day that read in the paper, Lamar Hunt ruins the future of tennis. And the battle was basically over control. Who's going to control the players? Who's going to control the prize money? Who's going to control amateur status? Who's going to control professional status? So he would, I can't believe he did this, but he would tell me, listen, there's this thing, you need to go to the subway and go here and go there. And I learned the subway system, and I took some tours. I was doing this stuff on my own. He would give me a pass, say, here, go watch the tennis out on the grounds. Wimbledon's got these great grounds, and you can go just walk around and watch tennis. And I love tennis. I still play it to this day. And lo and behold, she's 19 years old, Yvonne Goolagong, and I see her play. And it's like poetry in motion, if you've ever seen her play. But she's only seeded. She's a known quantity. She's third seed in the tournament. But on consecutive days, I saw her beat Billie Jean King and Margaret Court. And I have never to this day forgotten the electricity in the crowd at Center Court at Wimbledon, watching this 19-year-old just dismantle the best American player in the world and the best Australian in the world. Now, the interesting thing about Yvonne Goolagong was she's kind of at her heart a family gal. And what was interesting about her is she won some major tournaments. Then she got married. She had children. She came back, and I'm going to check the dates here. She beat Chris Everett in 1980 at Wimbledon. We know who Chris Everett is. She's the only female player in tennis history to give birth to a child, come back in her career, and win a major tournament. That, for me, is the greatest sports story that I've ever encountered. I got to see her, touch her, meet her, up hand, up close. It was like, wow, this is something. And I was there. A quote from a 1971 New York Times article said that at age 14, she flowed around the court. She was the kind of natural you see once in a long time. She didn't know how to make her shots, of course, but she was always there in the right place without even thinking about it. Pretty cool stuff. That's my greatest sports memory. And like I said, I've seen a lot. Okay. Two seasons ago, the Chiefs were 9-7. And at the end of the season, they knocked off the San Diego Chargers in the last game and knocked them out of the playoffs. And I was going back to the locker room with my family, my brother Clark and Daniel, and I think some of my nephews and maybe one or two of my sons. And I was thinking to myself, I can remember thinking, well, it's going to be the old speech that I've heard a million times before. It's good to get that last victory. We can build on it for next year, which is a cliche that, thank God, Andy Reid has stopped using. He walked into the locker room. And he was kind of, Andy's a very jovial, affable man. He was dancing and laughing. And, you know, let's enjoy it. Take care of yourself tonight. Don't get in trouble. And then he got the room quiet. And he said, I want you to remember how this tastes. This is bitter. We're not in the playoffs. He named the two games that we gave away earlier in the season. One was a loss to Tennessee in the opening game. We blew it. We weren't ready. But in that moment, he was supportive, but then he turned right around and challenged that team to come back and be a better version of themselves. Now, that better version of themselves unfolded last season when we were 1-5, not so quick, and then we won 11 in a row. He knew he had a special team. And this is something about leadership. We spend a lot of time talking about leadership, but we very, very rarely don't use the word heroic leadership. And Andy Reid would be the last person to say, I'm a hero. He knows what it's like, for example, to lose a grown child to drug addiction. He knows that. He knows the pain and the suffering that that family went through. But he also knows he's dealing with young men, and they need a swift kick in the rear at key moments. And that's kind of what leadership is about, knowing when to support and knowing when to say, wait a minute, I got to challenge you. There are four things that heroic leaders sort of think about a lot. First off, you know who you are. You know what you are, and you know what your values are. The second thing is you seem to be sort of unflappable when all this change is coming about. There isn't one job that the Kansas City Chiefs that I could walk in and stay employed at, or the Missouri Mavericks for that matter. I would get fired very, very quickly. Think about that. I don't have the computer literacy that many of you have. I have a lot for a guy that's, well, I'm not even going to say I'm old. I'm still young. But I went and took some classes. I mean, I got an education and I figured it out. But I can't do the things that I see you young people do that are here today. I can't, the people at the Chiefs. Somebody said to me, hey, we need to edit out every play of the last game and get it queued up and graded. I would just be like, what, do you want that next year or what? No, we need it tomorrow morning, right? Okay. But leadership is about being able to put all the pieces together and direct people. And everybody has a chance to be a leader at different times in your life. You have to step up. It doesn't matter what your job is, okay? Now, here's one that's a little different. I've talked about who you are, willingness to be flexible, and this one is love. When a young man comes to either the Missouri Mavericks or the Kansas City Chiefs for a tryout, they're already afraid. They're already on the edge of fear. What's the point, right? You don't win anything by that. You really want to bring out the best. And when you want to bring out the best in another person, it means you actually care about that person. You want to see their best. You want to leave them knowing they did their best. And that's one of the things that I see with great leaders, great coaches, great executives. You don't rule by fear or intimidation. It doesn't work. And the last thing is to understand that there is no external switch for motivation. The motivation, leaders need to understand that the motivation for anybody is going to come from within. What the leadership needs to do is make the environment that kind of place. And that's extremely difficult to do. Okay. How are we doing on time? We got about 10 minutes. Okay. I'm gonna leave you one other thing. How many of y'all have read Alexis de Tocqueville? Anybody know who that is? Only the old guys with beards. Well, we used to have to read this stuff in high school. De Tocqueville came to the United States in the 19th century from France. And you have to remember, for the younger people here, this country was a great experiment. There had been no other government that had ever been formed like the United States. And the Europeans, specifically that culture, were watching very carefully to see how is the great American experiment going to work out. And so de Tocqueville came over and he wrote these books, and there were other people that came and studied it. Now, some of the things they noticed, and these are kind of humorous, were Americans were not so great on their personal hygiene. Lots of spitting of tobacco in the streets. The manners in general weren't very good. Wolfing down of food, bad food, really bad food. You know, Europeans, they have good food. They think about that. We have better food now, of course. But they came away almost unanimously, these people, with four things that I think you can think about for our country. The very first thing is they noticed that Americans were incredibly industrious. They were busy, industrious, they got after it, they weren't afraid to work hard. They noticed that Americans were almost honest to a fault. Like they were kind of taken away by this sort of open honesty. The third thing was there was a deep belief in marriage, they noticed, in the American way of life. You know, there was sort of this tie to the family, how important that was. And the last thing, there was sort of a relationship with religion meaning to sort of bind you back to some core values or beliefs. If you think about it, that's the root of the word religion is religare, which means to bind you back. And if you think about that, everybody has to have some sort of beliefs or core values. Something that binds you back to something. You can't just, it's great to believe in yourself, but that's going to get very tiring after a while, especially when you find out you're flawed. And so if you look around our landscape today, I would challenge everybody here to sort of think about these observations that kind of made our country great. It isn't for me to proselytize or anything like that. That's not what this is about. It's for us to think about changing your perspective and thinking about, are we as industrious as we need to be? Are we honest? How are we in our relationships? Are we honest in our relationships? And lastly, what do we believe? What are your beliefs? Abraham Lincoln said it this way: you cannot help the poor by destroying the rich. You cannot strengthen the weak by weakening the strong. You cannot bring about prosperity by discouraging thrift. You cannot lift the wage earner up by pulling down the wage payer. You cannot further the brotherhood of man by inciting class hatred. You cannot build character and courage by taking away people's initiative and independence. You cannot help people permanently by doing for them what they could and should do for themselves. He says it better than I could ever say it, and I think we would all agree that we should listen to those words. Thank you for your time and attention today.
Well, thank you so much. I'm sure we've got some questions and we've got some time. So go ahead and get your hands up where I can see them. But first of all, I'll start with my own question, if you don't mind. You mentioned your father was loyal almost to a fault.
He was.
Which is interesting in an industry where loyalty is such a big deal. Everyone's worried about, is their player loyal to the team? Is the team loyal to the city? How do you think that shaped the way he formed the sports that he was involved in?
Every year is a new season for sports, the teams. And any good coach or owner or general manager will tell you, yes, we can draft players, we can find certain personalities, we can get free agents, we can do all these sorts of things. But what people have to know on a team is I've got your back. And I found it amusing this year, we were 1-5, and my poor brother was being asked, was he going to retain Andy Reid? We know the evidence shows frequent firing of coaches does not work. The data proves it. Cleveland Browns prove it unequivocally. They fired Bill Belichick. Since then, they've had 8 coaches and at least 16 starting quarterbacks. By the way, the trivia question, who was Bill Belichick's defensive coordinator from 1991 to 94? Nick Saban, the most successful college coach in history, other than Bear Bryant, and they're all from that Bama school. But Nick Saban said, everything I learned from Bill Belichick. The Cleveland Browns have not been patient, and that's, you know, they have their reasons. But the evidence seems to show that this loyalty, you got to walk through the valleys with your coaches, with your people. In business, you got to walk through the valleys. Certainly, there are times when things aren't a good fit, or you know, people do things that it's just not going to work. But loyalty wins the day.
Fantastic. We've got one right here.
You talked about perspective, and you've had a very interesting perspective to kind of a wide variety of sports. Lots of things in sports are changing. Lots of things are staying the same. Can you talk about one thing that you see that's exciting to you about the change in sports, and then one thing that's kind of persevered in your long perspective?
Personally, I think that the sports is oversaturated. There's too much of it on television. There's too much programming. There's too many games in all the sports, and that's tedious for even a really passionate fan to keep up with. I realize that each team wants to grow their fan base, and they'll bombard you, if you know that, until you don't want to hear it anymore. So I think that I have that concern. I mean, even ESPN can tell you through their ratings that things like college basketball, the ratings are severely down for just the multitude of games, baseball, things like that. I don't know if you all know this. Last year, the Chiefs were playing the Texans, and the Astros and the Royals were playing at the same time. Astros and Royals were playing in a playoff game, and the Chiefs and Texans were, actually maybe the Texans were just playing somebody else. The Texans were like 1-5, or like we were 2-5. The Texans game was like, blew away the playoff baseball game, just blew it away ratings-wise. So that's the first part of the question. Tell me the second part, if you remember it, because I don't.
What one thing that's persevered throughout the years that hasn't changed?
Okay. I think that sports does build character. I think there's evidence that participation in sports, participation in the arts, participation in music, participation in those types of things builds a certain type of character in individuals. It teaches you how to follow through. I played on a team in 9th grade in football. We scored 1 touchdown the whole year. And we remember the guy vividly who dropped the touchdown pass that could have won that game, where we actually scored a touchdown. I'll never forget his name. Great guy. Great. He'll never forget it. But it taught us something about perseverance. By the time we were seniors in high school, we were undefeated, and we beat the class 2A state champions in a public school, and we were in a private school. So I think that the character is there. I mean, it makes a difference. You got to be busy. You got to be occupied. You got to be about something.
Make sure you get your hands up, because I can't really see too well in the back. But I think the interesting thing for me about sort of the Hunt family in general is all the different sports you're involved in. So it's not just we're really good at football teams or really good at hockey. It's the sports industry in general. What makes, what has made you guys so successful within the sports industry? What is it about sports and entertainment?
I have 3 son-in-laws that say, well, it must be in your DNA. somehow we seem to be hardwired by it. Again, I would go back to some of those core things of being loyal, being a good family to work for. I do think we know what we're doing when we walk into a staff meeting or when we're around the marketing or the PR or the ticket sales. We have a working knowledge of the business because we've been around it so long. And my dad was an idea a minute, and I think if you just sat in a meeting with him, you absorb that stuff. You know, you learn from other people. And my dad would be the first to stand up here today and say, hey, look, tennis. We did it for 19 years. We had world championship tennis. It was a great run. We did some good things, but we never really built a sustainable business model. Soccer, the first go-around, really struggled. You know, it wasn't quite the time. Now the Major League Soccer, as you know, if you're Sporting KC fans, and I'm sure there are a lot of them here, it's a great experience, and they've got a really good foothold into the community, and hopefully we'll build that TV, you know, that TV audience over time, for sure.
Got one in the back here for you.
What is it about Kansas City that you think that makes us such a big sports city? And why do you think that some sports do better here than others?
No oceans, no mountains. What else are we going to do? Well, I live here. You know, I grew up in Dallas, and this is my home, Kansas City. I have my wife and I have, we're a blended family. We have 9 children, and a bunch of them, all of them graduated from, you know, high schools here, mainly in Johnson County. But I am state line blind. I really am. I think the fans here are very passionate because there's a collegial feel that the college teams are supported in a great way. And I mean, I'm thinking of KU and MU and all those sort of things, K-State. And there's obviously an athletic program here, especially the basketball program that does well. And there are other programs that you have here at UMKC that do well, that retain, keep people interested. I do think that it has something to do with the sports here are affordable. The average blended ticket price for the Chiefs is in about $80. If you go to New England, the average blended ticket price is something like $180. Think about that in perspective. The St. Louis Blues, which we go to their games, and it's a very family-friendly deal, their average blended price is about $60 to go to a game. That's actually pretty reasonable for a National Hockey League. You go in Chicago, it's like $180 to sit in the lower bowl. It's, you know, so I do think there's an affordability. There's a standard, a level of living here that's less expensive and things like that. But I also think, you know, I think this town is a baseball town in a lot of ways. You saw that. You had a long history of baseball here before the Royals were formed, if you will, in the early 70s, late 60s when they came back. The Chiefs have always been, you know, sort of a beloved team, a team, you know, you can get irritated at certain years for sure. But those of us that live in sports, we know there are going to be years like that. We understand that, and that's that perseverance. This is a great sports town. There's really nothing like it in the United States that I can compare it to. I mean, I've been to every market. I've seen games. You know what? I'll take that back. Pittsburgh. Now, as far as your question of what will work and won't work here, you know, the history has been baseball and football, soccer. Clearly, the Sporting KC team, that franchise, is probably in the top 2 or 3 in the Major League Soccer. I think Portland and Seattle, you know, those experiences are, Portland's is unbelievable. In fact, if you ever get a chance, turn on a Portland Timber game and watch the crowd chant. It's a remarkable thing. But I think, you know, you've done that. With hockey, you know, we're in a growth stage. I mean, there's some growth that needs to be done. But we do very, very well at the AA level, and we have really good crowds. And, you know, we're making it a business. It works.
Right here in the middle.
I have a question about gaming and esports. And do you even see gaming like Super Smash Bros. Tournaments or Dota tournaments that fill up whole arenas in Seattle, that kind of thing? Are those sports and... You know, does anybody in your family have interest in those?
Well, it looks like fun. I wish I could play it. I'm not quick enough. You know, it's funny. I was talking to my son, my oldest son, who's 28 today, and he was talking about what would an investment be like that. And I said, I don't know, but why don't you go find out for us and let us know. I'm not that dialed into it, but obviously it's extremely popular. I think the purpose behind it, again, is to engage people into the sports and into the world. Is it a sport? Maybe it's like golf. You know, there's it's highly skilled. I mean, you got to be very, very skilled to play golf. You know, not necessarily super athletic. There's a sort of degree of athleticism in golf. You know, from from those who kind of look, they're not very athletic, to, you know, Rory McIlroy, who looks like he could, you know, box you to death. But it's a phenomenon. I don't know that much about it, like I said, but I've seen it, you know, happening, and it seems to be something of this generation that engages people, and I think all the sports people love it that way.
All right, we got another one here.
Lamar would be an easy one, I guarantee you. Now, this is one outside of sports I think would be good, especially for the younger folks, to maybe comment on some of the substantial investments that your father made in Kansas City. There were big bets that did pay off, but really did help Kansas City.
Right. I mean, one of the things about being in sports is it's sometimes you might say it's a luxury item for wealthy people. I mean, if you look at the ownership groups in sports, they generally have driven their businesses with other types of things, and then they wake up one day and say, oh, I think I'll go buy this or that or get involved in that. One of the things that our family does, and I mentioned this to Beverly, our company, our main umbrella company, we have Loretto, that's something that's my own personal interest, but we have a company called Unity Hunt, and the idea was my father formed it so that the siblings, my two brothers and sister and I, would all sort of stay together, work together, go through the ups and downs together with certain investment strategies. But the tone for that was set by my father, who invested back in the community of Kansas City. And for those of you that don't know this, Worlds of Fun was built by our family. So we owned it from 1972 to 1995, and we sold it to Cedar Fair out of Cleveland, Ohio, okay? So we built that, and we also invested in real estate and the underground, the property around Worlds of Fun, and that's Hunt Midwest. And under the underground, we have 13 million square feet of rentable space, of which we just crossed the 6 million square feet threshold. And we have all sorts of things down there. We may even have your tax returns down there, and I'm not kidding on that. We rent space to the IRS, the National Archives, the U.S. Postal Service, Russell Stover, Jack Stack, places you can think of. There's a myriad of companies. A Parisi Coffee, they've got like 400,000 or 500,000 square feet, and there's got these coffee stacked. But that's one of the parts of the business. And then the other part of the business is we're doing homes for the elderly, nursing home type situations. We have 6 or 7 of those properties in Kansas City. Mission 106, there's an apartment complex going up in there. So we've typically been more in Missouri over the years, and we have some home building and things like that. So it was my dad's intention to form these companies and give back and create really jobs. My dad loved creating opportunities for other people, and really, quite frankly, that's what I like to do. I would recommend a book called Conscious Capitalism by the guy that created Whole Foods. He takes no salary from the company anymore. But what he's really talking about is we need to be more conscious about capitalism and extolling the virtues of capitalism, the good things. Yes, there are the stories out there of exploitive capitalism, but capitalism in and of itself, it's imperfect, but it sure creates jobs, and it's lifted more people out of poverty than any other system in the history of man. Conscious capitalism, I can't think of the guy's name, but it's worth reading to be conscious about this.
All right, I think we have time for one more question, and it's right here in what has turned out to be question row here, so.
I don't really have a question, but I have a quick story about your dad. When I was 21 years old, I worked for the Kansas City Chiefs, and that was my financial backing as I was getting my economics degree from this great institution. And one Sunday, I was guarding the locker room to the Chiefs, and it had been a long night, long weekend, I was cramming for finals. And I had my chair leaned up against the wall with my economics book on my lap, and I fell asleep. Well, your dad would always come in, he'd run the spirals to Arrowhead, come back down. And when he came back down, he came down and he saw me, and I was leaning against the wall, sound asleep. And he came up, I don't know how long he was there, but he ended up kicking my chair. And my chair fell forward, and the economics book hit the floor. And as I look up, thinking maybe it's my supervisor, I'm looking up to Mr. Hunt. So the first thing out of my mouth was, I'm sorry, I guess I'm fired. He said, no, son. He goes, are you cramming for exams? I said, yes, sir. He said, keep on going. Just, would you mind if I go in the locker room and take a shower? So I said, yes. So let's advance 20 years. I'm on a flight from Kansas City to St. Louis, and I'm on a Southwest flight. And I take the back of the plane because at that point in time, they had three seats that faced each other in the back, and that was kind of like my little office I had. I'm sitting there, I ordered a cup of coffee, and I look up, and, well, I hadn't looked up yet, but this gentleman says, is the seat taken? And I look up, and it's your father. And he sat in the aisle, and I sat in the window. And I recalled to him that story. And he looked at me, and he said, you know what? I've had a lot of success in my life, but I'm going to tell you what. I'm going to take success for your success. He goes, what are you doing now? I said, I'm a vice president of a company here in Kansas City. He goes, well, congratulations, you got your degree and everything. I said, yes, sir, I did. And he goes, you know, I'm going to take credit for that because if I hadn't kicked your chair and got you back on the right track, you never would have graduated.
Yeah, my dad flew coach up until he got cancer in 1998. He never went first class. We were dragged to Europe. We had to sit like this. And we still do it as a family, generally as a tradition, at least my group does, and we fly coach. I'm A1 through 15 or whatever at Southwest, and that's my baby, that plane. Yes, he was going to Columbus. Right. Yeah, yeah. And I actually, you know what, I once he passed, I was the one who was on the ground in Columbus, so that's where I accumulated all my points, and I know those flights very, very well, Kansas City to St. Louis, St. Louis to Columbus. So, yeah.
Great. Well, that's an excellent place, I think, to leave it. Thank you again for joining us. It's been fantastic.
Oh, I got one more thing. Okay, I got one other thing, and if you can write this down. So part of this deal is thank you for having me, but we want to invite everybody for free that's here today to come to a Missouri Mavericks game Sunday, April 17th. 4:00, first is the puck drop. It's a playoff game. It's at the Silverstein Ice Centers Arena. It's right out in Independence. And the young lady who's going to be your point of contact, her name is Carson Wilson, K-A-R-S-O-N Wilson. It's kwilson@missourimavericks.com. If you will email her and tell her that you attended this talk today and you want to go to the game, you don't have to. It's just an invitation. She will put free tickets for you at will call for the Sunday playoff game. We do not know who we're going to be playing at this point. We think it'll either be Cincinnati or the Quad Cities. We're hopeful it's not Tulsa. They give us fits. So Kay Wilson Carson is her first name, K-A-R-S-O-N, at MissouriMavericks.com. She knows to expect this. If you want to go, you be our guest. Parking is free at the Silverstein Ice Centers Arena. Your tickets will be free. There's not a bad seat in the house. It's all lower bowl seating. If there's any snafus or anything like that, Beverly can help too. She's going to be a point of contact for you, okay? Sunday, April 17th, 4 p.m. So if you come, give us some feedback. Carson is a young lady who invented something. We had her call every season ticket account. That was over 600 accounts. Some of us helped her. And we wanted to know if people were going to renew their season tickets for the next year. And when they said they were not, we did an exit. She thought of, I want to do an exit interview with these people. So she actually created and designed an exit interview wanting to know what was the main reason. And the number one reason was people were moving, they were changing jobs and moving away. It wasn't, thank goodness, it wasn't the product or some experience they'd had at the arena. So, and in some cases there were people had died, which happens. But she created that, and that was the kind of initiative that she's a superstar. She created this exit interview on, why aren't you renewing your season tickets? Give me the reason. So, listen, thank you all. I hope to see you there. If I'm there walking the concourse, tell me that you saw me. But I appreciate your time so much. Thanks.
Thanks again.